Welcome to worship at St. Mark's Lutheran Church in Claremont, North Carolina. It is good to see you all on this Reformation Sunday, also the 21st Sunday after Pentecost. And welcome to all those who are joining us online or also out in the parking lot. We are glad that you are also here. If you would take just a moment and sign one of the welcome cards that is in your pew, to let us know that you are here. You also can put any prayer requests or notes for the office on there. That will help us to stay in contact with all of you. And as I shared last week, and as we started to do last week, we are going to continue with sharing of the peace after our intercessory prayers. In the past, people have often hugged or shook the hands with one another, and you are welcome to do that. But because of COVID numbers and COVID itself or colds or whenever it might be, if you would prefer to just say peace by showing the peace sign or giving a fist bump or an elbow, whatever it might be, that's all fine too. Or just waving and saying peace be with you. So we will have that later on in our service. This week, our worship and music team will be meeting on Tuesday evening. And we will have wonderful Wednesdays with our book study on Wednesday night. And then next Saturday evening, we will be celebrating the marriage of Zachary Gardner and Mally Yang. And so please keep them in your prayers this week as they prepare for their marriage. And next Saturday evening, don't forget to turn back your clock, as we will be returning to the regular time versus daylight savings time. And so if you come next week at the regular time, I guess you'll be early. So that'll be all right. Next weekend, we also will be having our noisy offering, as it will be the first Sunday of the month. And it is also All Saints Sunday, and so we're remembering those who have gone before us and are in the church triumphant now. After worship next Sunday, if you would like to ask any questions about the information that was mailed to you about our Constitution, about our budget for 2023, next Sunday after worship, that will be your opportunity to ask those questions. And then we will have our congregation meeting the following Sunday on November 13th. So please be here for that congregation meeting. I want to thank all those who participated last night in Trunk or Treat. Thank you for being here. Thank you for decorating, wearing costumes, for just welcoming people to the church grounds. And I hope you all enjoyed your time together. In the newsletter and also on the tables outside our sanctuary doors today, there are these little welcome Thanksgiving, thanks offering sheets. Welcome Sunday will be on November 20th. And if you would like to purchase in honor or in memory of someone, a mom, they're asking that you fill this out and return this to the office no later than November 15th. If you have any questions about that, I guess you probably could ask Tamara or one of the other ladies who's a part of it. I do want to say a special happy anniversary to Terry and to Tamara. Today is how many years? 47 years of wedded bliss each day. So, but we tell them happy anniversary. Also this week, Linda Hewitt had a birthday. Happy birthday to her. Mike Baker, Susan Bullock, happy birthday. Brenda Sigmund, Cindy Baker. Tamara's was yesterday. She's just partying all weekend. Arlene Bird is tomorrow. Linda Lighton is also this week. And Elijah Hedrick. And the flowers on our altar this morning are given in memory of Gary Art, who would have had his birthday on October 27th. And those are given by Denise. So thank you. I do have a few prayer concerns to share with you this morning. Jan Carpenter had, oh, she's here, yay! She had a heart procedure this week, and her recovery is going well, and she is here in worship today. So it's good to see you, Jan. And Brenda Sigmund had a stroke last Sunday. She is still hospitalized at this time, and they are thinking maybe she'll be released tomorrow, but I'll know more this afternoon. So please keep Brenda in your prayers. Also, please continue to keep in your prayers the family of Inabel Little upon her death, Susan Bullock upon the death of her sister, Carolyn. Please keep Loretta Gilbert's family in your prayers. We had her funeral service here on Friday as she passed away on Monday. And yesterday we celebrated the life of Georgie Mae Deal. So please keep her also in your prayers. I believe those are all my announcements for this morning. Again, welcome to worship. Thank you for being here. And now let us prepare our hearts and our minds to give thanks and praise to our Lord. Please stand as you are able for our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who is eager to forgive and who loves us beyond our days. Amen. Dear friends, together let us acknowledge our failure to love this world as Jesus does. God of mercy and forgiveness, we confess that sin still has a hold on us. We have harmed your good creation. We have failed to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with you. Turn us in a new direction. Show us the path that leads to life. Be our refuge and strength on the journey. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and friend. Amen. Beloved of God, your sins are forgiven and you are made whole. God points the way to new life in Christ, who meets us on the road. Journey now in God's abiding love through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, gracious Lord, we thank you that your Holy Spirit renews the church in every age. Pour out your Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep them steadfast in your word. Protect and comfort them in times of trial. Defend them against all enemies of the gospel and bestow on the church your loving peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Our first lesson today comes from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 31. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took their hand and to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I were their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. The gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second reading comes from the book of Romans, chapter 3. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law. For through the law, though the law comes, through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed and is attested by the law and the prophets, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. They are now justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by his blood, effective through faith. He did this to show his righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over the previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that he himself is righteous and that he justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. Then, what becomes of boasting? It is excluded by the law. By the works? No, but by the faith, law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from works prescribed by the law. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I'd like to invite all the children to come up for the children's sermon. I'm going to give you a job to do. Good morning, little blessings from God. How are we this morning? Good? What's going to happen tomorrow night? What's happening tomorrow night? Special. Halloween, that's right. And what do you say when you go to someone's house and knock on the door? Trick or treat, that's right. Well, I'm going to talk to you about tricks. Do you believe, or did you know, that when Jesus was preaching and teaching long ago, some of the early leaders in the church thought that he was performing tricks? Did you know that? Well, they weren't tricks. They were miracles. For example, some of the miracles that Jesus performed, he turned water into wine. That was his first miracle. He turned water into wine. Another miracle is he calmed the angry storm when the fishermen were out fishing and it was raining and the wind was blowing and the waves on the lake were rolling and they were frightened, and he told the storm to be still, and it calmed down. He also performed a miracle of healing 10 lepers. Leprosy was a disease back then that if you got it, you had to be moved away from everybody else. And so they were kind of like in a group all by themselves, and Jesus healed them of this terrible disease so that they could go back to live with their families. Another miracle he performed was he raised somebody from the dead. He raised Lazarus from the dead. He did all of these, and they weren't tricks. They were miracles. I kind of like to think of miracles as special gifts from God. And sometimes gifts come in all sizes, don't they? Sometimes they're in big boxes, and sometimes they're in small boxes, but they're still special. And the miracles that Jesus performed, like walking on water, turning the water into wine, healing Lazarus, I think of those as the big gifts. But do you know that we experience miracles every day? What might be some miracles that you would experience every day? Can you think of some? Love. That's exactly right. The love of your family and grandparents. What about every morning when the sun rises and the sun sets? Do you ever think of those as miracles? No, but they are. They're miracles from God. What about a flower blooming in the spring or the leaves turning colors now? Yeah, those are miracles. Or whenever somebody celebrates the birth of a new baby, that's a miracle. Or even the birth of a newborn puppy or kitten, those are miracles too, aren't they? Yes, those are the miracles we experience every day that we sometimes take for granted. In my lifetime, I'm going to be honest, I haven't seen anybody walk on water. I haven't seen anybody turn water into wine. But I have seen the miracles of a newborn baby, a sunrise, a sunset, someone that maybe has been very ill, and all of a sudden they get better. That's a wonderful miracle. Yep. All of those are blessings or special gifts from God. But the most wonderful miracle is happened on what? That's right, and what happened after Jesus died on the cross? They buried him, and what happened? That's exactly right. He arose from the dead. That's the greatest miracle of all. And you know what? The biggest treat of all is that because of his death and resurrection, our sins are forgiven, and we, one of these days, are going to do the same thing. When Jesus comes again, we're going to be able, if our loved ones have passed on, they are going to be able to rise again and go home with or go with Jesus just like we are. That's the greatest treat. That's a treat that no one can take from us. In other words, we can enjoy that treat 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days out of the year. And no one can take that treat from us. Well, I have a treat for you. And what is that? And it's a little pack of M&Ms, and there's a cross. Now, M&M's have what? Chocolate, but they have different what? When you open them up. Colors, that's right. So when you eat those M&M's, I want you to think about all the little miracles that God performs in our lives every day. In other words, and there's also a what in there? A cross. And I want you to think about that most wonderful miracle of Jesus dying on the cross for our sins and coming back to life so that we can have forgiveness of sins also. Can you do that for me? Well, you have a wonderful day and a wonderful Halloween, and we'll see you next Sunday. Thank you.
Please stand for our gospel affirmation. according to St. John, the 8th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The Son has a place there forever. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Let us pray together. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I'd like to begin my message this morning by sharing with you a story told by Pastor Tim Zingle to illustrate his sermon entitled "Saved by Grace Through Faith." The story goes, there once was a boy named Roy who desperately wanted love and attention from his parents, but he didn't really know how to receive it. As a result, Roy got into a lot of trouble. He found that he got plenty of attention from his parents for all the trouble that he caused, which seemed close enough to love for that 10-year-old boy. Every time he got into trouble, his parents would question him long and hard, trying to find out his reasons for the way he was acting. "Why do you do that, Roy? What's wrong?" they would ask. But Roy just stared at the floor, not answering and not looking at his parents. Finally, his parents would say, "You know, we will have to punish you for this." And Roy knew this, and he expected it. He was familiar with punishment and knew how to cope with it. There would be no TV and no dessert after supper, and he would have to stay home after school instead of going to activities for a few weeks. Roy never seemed to mind the punishment. It was just part of getting his parents' attention. One night, Roy's parents received a phone call from the police, and the officer informed them that Roy and some other boys had vandalized the school. They'd been caught trying to set a fire in one of the classrooms. Well, Roy's parents rushed to the police station and talked to the lieutenant in charge for well over an hour. Finally, Roy was released into their custody after they had agreed to help pay for the damage to the school. The ride home from the police station was silent. Roy sat between his parents in the front seat waiting, but no one spoke. When they got home, Roy went to his room and waited for his parents' usual lecture and the terms of the punishment. Finally, his mom came in, looked at Roy, and said simply, "You've really hurt us tonight." And then she left the room. Later, Roy's father came into his room and said, "Roy, do you have homework to do?" And the question took him by surprise. "What? Yes, I guess so." "Well, you better get your work done then." And his father left the room, leaving Roy staring at his book, wondering what was wrong. At bedtime, his parents came in again, and they brought him a snack and told him that when he was finished eating, he needed to turn off the lights and get some sleep. And then they left without saying another word. Roy ate his snack, turned off the lights, and laid on his bed for nearly an hour. But he just could not sleep. Finally, he jumped up, ran out of his room, down the stairs, and jumped right into his mother's arms, crying his heart out, "I'm sorry, I'm sorry. I hurt you, I'm sorry. sorry I've been so bad. Please forgive me. Roy's parents held him for a long time, shedding a few tears of their own, and outpoured all the years of hurt, the need for love and attention, as his parents told him over and over again how much they loved him, in spite of all the things that he had done to disappoint them. That night, Roy finally learned to receive the love and forgiveness his parents felt for him. There may be some of us here today, including myself, who can relate to this story. During my childhood, there were times that I did things that I knew were wrong, and I know I must have hurt my parents when I did them. And I have known their forgiveness and love for me as I expressed my own sorrow and asked for forgiveness for my actions. This story expresses a similar dynamic to the struggle that Martin Luther encountered in his early adulthood, which led to him discovering the truth of the gospel, especially the fulfillment of the grace of God, which ultimately led us to the Reformation of the Church, which we are celebrating today. It was on October 31st, 1517, that Martin Luther was said to have nailed his complaints. Yes, complaints. What he thought should be changed about the Catholic Church on the doors of the church in Wittenberg, Germany. It said he purposely picked that date to post them because the next day there would be a lot of people coming to the church for the Festival of the Saints, the festival we will celebrate next Sunday. He wanted as many people as possible to know how he felt about what needed to be reformed and made different and new in the church. Well, what gave Martin Luther such authority to post a note like this and say what he was saying? He was a priest of the Catholic Church, and he was very well known in the community of Wittenberg and as an authority figure in the church, as he even taught at the university. It's said that Martin Luther, though, was a rebellious child. He was sent away to school after being told by his father that what he would be studying was to be a lawyer. However, Luther didn't want to be a lawyer. In fact, music was actually the subject that Martin preferred. And he also did very well in his study of the classics, becoming a professor. But it was on a trip, one year midsummer, that Martin's entire life changed. He was caught in a thunderstorm, and when a bolt of lightning struck the ground near where he was seeking shelter, he declared, "Help me, St. Anne! I will become a monk!" And so Luther entered a monastery where he studied and became an ordained priest and a professor of biblical studies and theology, which was very much a disappointment to his father. But becoming a monk and a priest did not help Luther in his own understanding of grace and forgiveness of God. Luther spent many hours in prayer confessing his sins and pleading with God to forgive him for all of his sins. He perceived himself to be a sinner, unworthy of God's love and mercy. It was not until he studied the letter to the Romans written by the Apostle Paul in preparation for a class that he was going to be teaching, that he began to develop a new understanding of God and salvation. In fact, it was from the verses we heard read today that Luther came to understand God's love and grace in a whole new way. He said to have declared these verses to be the heart of the gospel. Verses 23 and 24 say, "Since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, they are now justified by his grace as a gift through redemption that is in Christ Jesus." It is said that when Luther read these verses, suddenly his heart was freed and he understood faith and the means of grace. Luther now knew that people could not make themselves right with God, no matter how much time they spent in confession. People, by their own actions, could not build a bridge between themselves and God, because that gap had been created by human sinfulness. Instead, it was only from God through Jesus that we receive redemption and salvation at no cost to us. As Luther described it, every person is a sinner and a saint at the same time. A saint meaning one who is brought into a relationship with God, and a sinner being one who falls short of all that God wants for all God's children. But because of Jesus' death on the cross, whom God put forth for our own redemption, we are given forgiveness and eternal life. Like Roy in our story, on that day that Luther came to understand the power of forgiveness and the love of God, through the words of Paul, Luther's life changed, and his heart was open to receive the love and grace of God like he never had before. He understood that it was not about what he had done or would do with his life, but instead what God had already done through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. He was now free from the bondage of sin, free to believe fully in God's mercy, and free to have the faith that he was a forgiven and beloved child of God. As Martin Luther wrote in the Small Catechism, in his explanation of the Apostles' Creed, I believe that by my own understanding or strength, I cannot believe in Jesus Christ my Lord or come to him, but instead it is the Holy Spirit that has called me through the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts and made me holy, kept me in the true faith, just as he calls, gathers, enlightens, and makes holy the whole Christian church on earth, and keeps it with Jesus Christ in the one common true faith. No longer did Luther need to seek the love and forgiveness of God. He had already received it through Jesus Christ. This was the message that Luther wanted all people to hear. He felt the Catholic Church was misleading people by telling them that they had to buy indulgences to buy people out of purgatory so they could be forgiven of their sins and then enter into heaven after death. Luther also thought the church was wrong in telling people they weren't worthy to receive the sacrament of Holy Communion, as at that time only the priests were able to receive it. Luther wanted there to be a discussion about these things, and so he posted his statements, his 95 theses, on the door of the church so these discussions could begin. And it was because of these statements, these very first steps that Luther took, that the Lutheran church began to develop. It's because of these beginnings that people began to come to understand the love and mercy of God. It is because of Luther's determination and Luther's bravery that today we gather as sinners and saints of St. Mark's Lutheran Church to freely worship, giving thanks and praise to God and receiving the body and blood of Jesus Christ, hearing the words of forgiveness given to us by God. For it is by God's grace, a gift we are freely given, without cost or need for repayment, that we are made whole and in full relationship with God. Today we celebrate and give thanks to God, and we give praise to God for the forgiveness of sins and all that God has done and will continue to do for us. Today we celebrate and thank God for Saint Martin Luther and his tireless work sharing God's love, mercy, and the true gospel message with all people. Because of his work, we are made free to share the gospel of Jesus with others, living out our faith as disciples. For the grace we have received enables us and calls us to discipleship and to action. We, the people, the church, are made free to live our mission of proclaiming the gospel, making disciples, and embodying God's love for all the world to come to know. And that is an amazing gift of grace. So thanks be to God. Amen. Please stand for our hymn of the day.
Let us repeat together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He is seated in heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. In gratitude and humility, let us join together in prayer on behalf of all God's creatures. God, our fortress, We pray for the church. Write your law of love on our hearts of your people, that we remain steadfast in our witness to your grace. Hear us, O God. Mercy is great. God, our liberator, we pray for your earth. Bring new life to overused land and contaminated rivers. Reform and reorient our relationship with the environment, that we faithfully care for all of your creation. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God, our refuge and strength, we pray for the nations. Where there is an uproar, bring wise leadership and comfort for those in distress. Make wars to cease and peace to enter every land. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God, our very presence here in trouble, we pray for those in need. Show mercy to refugees and all the fleeing from danger. Shelter any without homes. Calm all who are facing illness, surgery, or a new diagnosis. Especially we pray for Harley, Erlene, Gary, Jan, Eva, Jerry, Jackie, Elena, Mike, Meredith, JD, Morgan, Kay, Sandy, Brenda, Tim, Richard, and Susan. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. God, our Redeemer, we pray for our congregation. Bless all who are preparing for baptism or affirmation of baptism. Open their hearts to your Holy Spirit. Teach them your word and give them courage to proclaim their faith. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God, our stronghold, we give thanks for those who have gone before us in faith, especially Martin Luther and all the reformers, Annabelle, Carolyn, Loretta, and Georgia May. Renew and return us as we strive to continue in your word. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. With grateful hearts, we commend our spoken and silent prayers to you, O God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us share Christ's peace with one another. And now let us prepare to receive the gifts of our offerings. you. Let us pray. Gracious God, in your great love, you richly provide for our needs. Make of these gifts a banquet of blessing and make us ready to share with all in need through Jesus Christ, who sets a table for all. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and who by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Yeah.
Heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love, you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one, let us pray the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The table is set and all are invited. Come, taste and see that our Lord is good.
Thank you.
Please stand as you are able. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. God of the abundant table, you have refreshed our hearts in this meal with bread for the journey. Give us your grace on the road that we might serve our neighbors with joy for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. God who gives life to all things and frees us from despair, bless you with truth and peace. And may the Holy Trinity, one God, guide you always in faith, hope, and love. Amen. Our service has ended, and now we are sent out into the mission field, into the neighborhoods, to share Christ's love with all we meet. And so let us remember our mission is to proclaim the gospel, to make disciples, and to embody God's love. Friends, disciples of Christ, go in peace. Christ is right beside you. Thanks be to God.